Well, thank you, President Meyer. More appropriately, yesterday, presentation of Augsburg Confession 1530, right? And also then 50 years later, the celebration of that event with the publication of the Book of Concord, or more appropriately, Concordia. So yesterday was Concordia's birthday, and that's really what brings me here to you today, and I thank you for that privilege. I greet you on behalf of the faculty and staff and students of really of the entire Concordia University system, but in particular, your partners in the gospel through Lutheran higher education at Concordia University, Wisconsin, and Concordia University, Ann Arbor. Presentation of Augsburg Confession, that may strike a more resonant tone with us than what I'm about to mention, but did you know that this is also the 200th anniversary, the bicentennial of the celebration of the birth of the English novelist Charles Dickens? That's exciting stuff, right? Actually, it's just a bit of trivia that's inconsequential to our time together, other than it provides a little bit of a platform for my brief remarks to you this afternoon. Because among those many, many novels that Dickens wrote was one that I think gives us a chance to do a little conversation today. The Tale of Two Cities, right? And he has perhaps one of his most famous lines ever is the one that begins that book, A Tale of Two Cities. Right? It was the best of times, it was the worst of times, right? Well, I'd like to tell a tale of two places, and to talk a little bit about the best and worst of times in those two settings as kind of background for a tale about a third that remains yet to be told. The first one is a tale of a place called Winfield, Kansas. It was founded in 1883, but my own experience with St. John's College, Winfield, Kansas, really began 35 years ago this summer. And I think back to that evening as my parents loaded up the Ford Granada in the driveway there at our home in Denver, Colorado, and began that 550-mile journey across the Great Plains of Kansas to Winfield. Winfield, for those of you who haven't been there, it's not in the middle of nowhere, but you can see it from there. And I was embarking upon what was, at least for me, and at least at that moment, the worst of times. It wasn't really meant to be that way, but I was homesick before I ever left home. And I have to understand, I didn't go to St. John's College, a little Lutheran college in Winfield, Kansas, with plans to become the president of the largest Lutheran university in North America. We are that. We're not the largest in the world. That's in Brazil. It has 140,000 students, and we're working on it. We've got to add a little extra parking, but anyway, I didn't go there planning to be a Lutheran college president or a Lutheran college professor or a Lutheran pastor or a Lutheran, for that matter. I grew up in a wonderful family, but it was an unchurched and non-Christian family. I went to St. John's College really for one reason only, and that was to play college basketball. And St. John's was the one school in all of America that recognized my athletic prowess and was going to give me that opportunity. It was a tough fall. I was homesick, didn't have access to Twitter or Facebook or cell phones. In fact, the only way of communicating with people at home was through the one payphone at the end of the hall, which nobody ever answered because if it wasn't for you, it wasn't worth the time. And we resorted to that ancient form of communication, letter writing, that students these days don't know a whole lot about. But as I reflect on those first few months, it really truly was miserable. I was sad, I missed my family, and I wanted to go home. Fortunately, basketball season eventually came around. What I didn't anticipate, though, when I first enrolled at St. John's, I was going to have the opportunity to play on what was arguably the worst team in the history of collegiate sports. We jumped out to an 0-11 start. That took us up to the Christmas break. And I really thought seriously about not coming back after Christmas, but I was persuaded by some teammates that, hey, come on back in January. It'll be fun. We're going to have this round robin with a couple of other Lutheran schools. And it'll be fun. So I came back, and it was a three-night event. We played Concordia, Austin, Texas, the first night, where my daughter Rachel will be a senior next year. They beat us. Then we played Concordia, Milwaukee. Never heard of the place. They were really good then, and they're really good now, too. But they also beat us. But there was still hope, because there was this other woeful team that was in the round robin. And as we watched them the first two nights, we recognized that, you know, they were just as bad as we were. They were not a Concordia. They were St. Paul's College from Concordia, Missouri. One thing we lack in the LCMS is imagination with regard to naming schools. But anyway, we played St. Paul's College, and it was a pretty good game. In fact, at halftime, we were leading. We didn't know quite how to behave in the locker room at that point. And it came out the second half, things got back to normal, but then we made a surge. It was back and forth, until on a nearly last second shot by an anonymous point guard from Denver, Colorado, we won. By one point, you might say, you weren't the worst team then in the history of collegiate sports, because you beat St. Paul's College from Concordia, Missouri. Well, there's a little more to this story. This was in January, and on the Monday following that round robin, we got the bad news that four of the other five starters on our team were academically ineligible for the second semester. So not only were not athletic, weren't particularly bright either, right? So we show up at our next game, we only have four guys. We have to reach into the bleachers and get people to suit up. We go to the concession stand. We place a call to Ray Winkle Hall. Fortunately, someone answers. They're on our team not only for that game, but for the rest of the season. Guys, some of them who'd never played basketball even in high school. Our season ended with one win and 25 losses. But some of those losses in January and February were of epic proportion. For example, we lost to the perennial powerhouse Barton County Community College, 148-50. We lost by 98 points. Not that we gave up 98. We lost by 98. It was one game all season where we worked on the stall late in the game to try and prevent a triple-digit defeat, and we succeeded at that. But you know, it was during the course of that freshman year, the worst of times, homesick, terrible basketball season, that I came to appreciate what St. Paul meant when writing to the Romans, he said. Well, actually, let me tell you what he said before he said what he said. First, he quotes the psalmist. All we like sheep face the slaughter. Now, that was a passage to which we could relate, right? I mean, every game, no matter home or away, we knew we were going to lose. We knew we were going to get beat bad. It wasn't like if the coach could stand up there and put X's and O's on the chalkboard and you know, if we just do that. All we like sheep face the slaughter. He says, we face peril, persecution, nakedness, sword. And yet in all these things, the apostle writes, and here was the key, in all these things, we're more than conquerors through Christ who loved us, more than champions through Jesus Christ who loved us. And that made a very profound impact on a young freshman who otherwise, by any standard, was a loser, right? More than conquerors through Christ who loved us. The story's better than that, though. You know, before I went to St. John's, I didn't want to go alone, so I drug a friend of mine who lived around the corner with me. He was a friend since junior high school, and a friend in high school. He didn't know what he wanted to do with his life. He didn't go to church either, but he played a little baseball and thought maybe he could play at St. John's. It was either that or go to the military. And finally, somehow or other, I convinced him. And some of you might know Reed Lessing, who was also confirmed during our freshman year of college, who otherwise had not been a member of the Lutheran Church. But members of my own family, my younger sister, who was then baptized and confirmed, and so that she wouldn't go through confirmation class alone, my mom went through instruction with her, and then she went by herself, and then an older brother, and then I was back in Colorado for graduate school after seminary, and I confirmed my own father. I mean, some of you had, you know, the stories of preachers' kids in confirmation. Can I try having your own dad in your confirmation class? Yeah. So they're really everyone in my family joined the church, and now my mom is in the nearer presence of Jesus in the church triumphant. And who do I have to thank for that? I thank you for that. I thank you for that because you're the ones who've supported Lutheran higher education, and it's made all the difference in my life, in the lives of my loved ones. I miss my mom. I missed her yesterday on my birthday. my sainted mother. I also miss my alma mater, right? Hail St. John's College, hail, champion of truth, in all the West, the best, the home of youth. That's the alma mater by Adolf Meyer. It has a line in the last stanza, ne'er will thy spirit die. Johnny's spirit will never die, I guess. School closed its doors in 1986, during the worst of times. It was at a comparable time, really, when that Concordia, Milwaukee, previously mentioned, was going through struggles of its own. There was a lot of discussion about maybe we ought to close down Concordia, Milwaukee. I mean, it was really this close, a hair's breadth separated from Concordia, Milwaukee from its closure. They said, you know, students, they'll go to River Forest instead. It's just 90 miles away. That's like saying Reed Lessing and I would have gone to Concordia, Nebraska. Never heard of the place. How did we ever end up there? Somebody else, however, said, let's give it one more chance. And somebody else must have said some 30 years ago, let's try something different. And they moved us from Milwaukee to Mequon, and we moved lock, stock, and barrel just over 30 years ago. 500 students is all we had. And we acquired the campus from the School Sisters of Notre Dame, and we could have acquired also the property immediately across the street for another $250,000, but gosh, we were never going to need all that space, so we let it go. A couple years ago, when I handed Sister Marilyn a check for $3.2 million for that same property, I said, whatever happened to that vow of poverty thing that you used to be so big on? There was no buyer's remorse because it's been a part of what have truly been the best of times. We've grown from 500 students to 8,000 students this fall. One out of every two students who's ever graduated from Concordia, Milwaukee, Mequon, we were founded in 1881, one out of every two who's ever graduated from our institution has graduated in the last dozen years. One out of every four has taken a degree or diploma from Concordia in the last 6 or 7 years. We've grown. Our growth has been exponential. We've grown through academic programs. We've grown our budget to over $100 million. We've grown as we've added facilities, all of those wonderful blessings. We've seen our church worker programs, which are at the heart and core of who we are, continue to be strong in spite of the fact that across our system, the numbers have shrunk. In fact, we had more church worker students at Concordia Mequon a year ago than Concordia Seward and River Forest combined. We've grown. But the most important growth is the one that's captured in our mission statement, which says, we are there as a Lutheran higher education community committed to helping students grow in mind, body, and spirit for service to Christ in the church and in the world. That's our mission, and the best is before us. And that brings us to the tale of the third city, the third place. It's a story that remains to be told. It's certainly one that's been being told for a while, and I would submit to you that the worst of times for Concordia Ann Arbor are now in the rearview mirror. They're in the rearview mirror. That is not to suggest that over the course of this last half century there haven't been wonderful times. This has been a tremendous institution that served our church wonderfully well and has accomplished much in the Lord's kingdom. But the best is ahead of us. There's a plan for the future. And let me briefly just say a few comments about that plan. It's been, in my experience, one of the most gratifying things that I've been a part of. The way that the different entities within the church have come together to address this. Our first order of business was to eradicate the debt that had been accumulated over a period of years here at Concordia Ann Arbor. And entities from the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod's Board of Directors to your district, to your district's extension fund, to the English district, to the Ohio district, and God willing, the Indiana district later this week. And with our support, have worked now to create a plan that's going to allow us to eliminate that debt so that we can start with a clean slate. For Concordia Milwaukee, that Concordia Mequon, that means an investment of over $9.5 million right now, and obviously millions more as we refresh in this campus, as we add programs, as we strengthen what we plan to do going forward in the future. The key, though, for our success as we move ahead is clearly is clearly about enrollment. And schools like ours are ones that rely entirely on robust enrollments. And a year ago at Concordia Ann Arbor, we saw a record enrollment for new students. We will exceed that mark this fall, and we're delighted to be able to report that to you today. At the same time, we're diversifying our portfolio of offerings so that we're reaching out not only to traditional undergraduate students, but like all of higher education, reaching out to a wide variety of students, adult learners, graduate students as well. They're not going to come here just because we think they should. This is a place that has to provide an excellent Christian education experience. And so the excellence has to be manifest in the variety of deliveries that we provide, whether it's on campus or through distance learning, whether it's traditional or non-traditional or graduate programs. We need to be able to provide quality and continue to provide quality co-curricular programs that attract students who want to come to places to do things like, well, maybe play basketball, for example, or music, or drama, or whatever the case might be. We're in the first stages of putting together a comprehensive campaign. Concordia Mequon, we're just announcing the completion of our $42 million campaign. It exceeded that by $48 million. God be praised. We're grateful. Concordia Ann Arbor, in all of its history, has never had a comprehensive campaign. We need to do that in order to help to build buildings, other capital needs, annual fund, endowment, and to assist in the reduction of the debt by helping you to recoup some of your generosity in providing support for the plan. Is it going to work? There's certainly some risk involved. Hebrews tells us, though, that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. If we're just going to base all this on looking back in the rearview mirror, maybe we won't make this decision. But we're looking forward, and we're looking forward to the opportunity for working together and doing something very special and something unique here in this place. In conclusion, let me just say briefly, while there's more to be developed as a part of this plan, we need you. We need you. We're here, we're rolling up our sleeves, we're eager to get busy, but we can't do this without you. And in order for this tale of this place to be one that really represents the best of times in the future, it's something that we've got to work at together. And we need to do that in tangible ways, through the support of your congregations, by sending your students to this place, by working with us in a partnership that I think will be one that we'll all be gratified as we look back on this in the not too distant future. In fact, it's my hope and it's my prediction that in a few years we'll look back on this and, you know, all of the tug and push and pull, and we'll ask ourselves the question, what was the fuss all about? Because the Lord is going to bless us mightily in our work together. Just to strip away a little more from the Tale of Two Cities, I think it ends something like this. It is a far, far better thing that we do now than ever we have done before. We're doing a good thing here together, folks. And I am grateful for that partnership and grateful for the privilege of working with you to accomplish what the Lord has in mind for this place. Thank you, President Martin.
Thank you. Good to work with you, brother.